On October 26, 1943, 440 German prisoners of war arrived in the heart of Manitoba's Riding Mountain National Park. Housed in the camp seen here, the POWs were employed in a woodcutting project to relieve a shortage of fuel wood in the province. Using Trimble's Sketchup program, I was able to create a digital reconstruction of the camp as it appeared in 1944. The camp was originally located on the northwestern shore of Whitewater Lake, seen here in the lower left-hand corner. The camp itself occupied the clearing in the center of the satellite imagery. As the buildings were removed in 1945 and 1946, it is now difficult to make out the former building locations. However, by overlaying a 1949 aerial photograph over Google's satellite imagery, we can now make out the outlines of the camp buildings. In the summer of 1943, the Carter-Aldinger Company out of Winnipeg built 14 buildings at a cost of over $200,000, making it, as one local newspaper reported, the largest work camp yet constructed in Canada for the purpose of cutting fuel wood. Unfortunately, a map of the camp has not survived, so by using architectural plans from similar buildings, historic photographs, paintings, and archaeological evidence, we're able to reconstruct the layout and buildings of the camp. Among the most important buildings were the POW bunkhouses. The majority of the POWs had been captured in North Africa and had previously been interned in Alberta. To accommodate the complement of 440 POWs, six bunkhouses, each with a capacity of approximately 75 men, were constructed. Pairs of bunkhouses were joined at the center, creating the H-shaped layout you see here. The middle bunkhouse also had a rather unique occupant, a black bear cub the POWs adopted in spring 1944. Left by POWs and guards alike, the bear became the camp mascot and was often photographed with the POWs. Each bunkhouse also had a leader who reported regularly to the POW in charge, the camp spokesman. Bunkhouses were heated by three wood stoves, and the POWs slept in bunk beds. Each bunkhouse pair was fitted with its own washroom facilities in the center portion. The camp featured hot and cold running water, toilets, and showers. Every morning, the POWs assembled and were counted on the parade ground. The POWs also would receive their work assignments for the day. The POWs were again counted in the evening to ensure that no one was missing from the camp. With no barbed wire fences or guard towers, responsibility of maintaining security and discipline at the camp fell to members of the Veterans Guard of Canada, seen here, and a small force of civilian guards. Operated by both civilian and POW personnel, this powerhouse provided electricity for the entire camp through the use of a diesel generator. From the administration building, the camp commander oversaw the day-to-day operations of the camp. In the 2 years that the camp operated, there were four camp commanders, one of whom, Major Keane, is seen here. The camp commander was also assisted by the highest-ranking German prisoner of war, the camp spokesman, and his orderlies. The camp also featured a small hospital that could handle minor injuries or illnesses. The hospital was staffed by POWs who had served as nurses and medics, as well as the only officer in the camp, Fritschof Gress, who served as the camp doctor. The kitchen and mess hall was large enough to accommodate both Canadian staff and German prisoners of war. However, both groups dined separately and had their own cooking staff. In order to accommodate the approximately 175 Canadian civilian and military staff employed at the camp, an additional bunkhouse was constructed. To keep the prisoners occupied while they were not employed, the prisoners also had access to a recreation hall. With the assistance of the YMCA, the prisoners had access to ping pong tables, card tables, a radio to listen to the war news, dart boards, writing tables, and a piano. Prisoners with musical talent formed a small band, while others put on plays in various stages on the stage seen in the picture here. A large barn housed animals, feed, and extra supplies needed for the wood-cutting operations. An officer of the Veterans Guard is seen here using one of the horses for a patrol, and as we zoom out here, you can see an image of prisoners preparing for bushwork. To accommodate any repairs that camp vehicles required, a large garage was built. German prisoners of war, who had experience as mechanics, conducted the work on the vehicles. The final building was the camp stables. This building housed additional horses used to transport POWs and to haul wood to the roadside. Following the end of the war, the camp was shut down in October 1945. The remaining POWs were transferred to other projects, and all buildings were removed from the site. While little remains of the site today, I hope that by creating a digital model of the site, we can improve our understanding of what life was like for German prisoners of war in Rocky Mountain National Park.